Welcome back to Voices from Afar. This is Sharon, Star of the Oracle, and I'm here with Bill and Jim Fetzer and Scottish John. We know him as John Daisley. And we've been talking with Jim Fetzer, and I brought up a question over break. I asked him if he could do a rundown on all the false flags throughout history, because what I've been putting together here is that the American people, but not only the American people, but the people around the globe, we've been played like a damn fool. When you look at all the false flags that have happened and how our emotions have been drawn to certain things and how we've been played. And so, Jim, could you do a little history for us all?
Yeah, but I'll do relatively recent history since the Spanish-American War, for example. Remember, the Maine was a battle cry because the battleship Maine blew up in Havana Harbor, but it was never shown that any Cuban or Spaniard had anything to do with it. It may simply have been a defect with the boilers. Nevertheless, Hearst newspapers use it to fan the flames, and it led to the Spanish-American War. The sinking of the Lusitania, what you don't hear about that is that it was, in fact, transporting weapons of war in its keel, so that it was actually a legitimate target for U-2 attack. When we had the attack on Pearl Harbor, we had already cracked the Japanese code. Franklin Roosevelt and others knew that it was coming, but they didn't warn the commander of Pearl Harbor. They let it happen because Roosevelt thought it was important to get us into the war against Germany. And we actually interfered with Japan's access to oil in the South Pacific. We deliberately provoked them into attacking us at Pearl Harbor. And, that led to all of the involvement and engagement in World War II. Of course, practically everyone knows about the Gulf of Tonkin, where we allegedly had these North American torpedo boats attacking the Turner, Joy, and the Maddox out there, which was ludicrous. It didn't happen. Lyndon himself would later admit, for all he knew, they were shooting at whales out there. But it has shades of a recent claim about Yemen, where the Houthi youth who are trying to overthrow a despotic regime in Yemen are alleged to have been attempting to attack an American vessel there. I mean, it's just absurd because they're recycling the whole Gulf of Tonkin scenario. JFK's assassination had many, many reasons. There was a whole group that were upset with him. He was threatening to shatter the CIA into 1,000 pieces. He wouldn't. He did not invade Cuba against the unanimous opposition of the Joint Chiefs. He signed an above-ground test ban treaty with the Soviet Union, contrary to their unanimous opposition. He was going to pull our forces out of Vietnam. All these led the chiefs to throw in on the and authorize even the assassination of the president of the United States. You had the anti-Castro Cubans who falsely believed he'd betrayed them at the Bay of Pigs. We had the Eastern establishment surrounding the Fed, who were worried because Jack was circumventing and going to get rid of the Fed on the ground that it was absurd for the United States to pay interest to a consortium of private banks to print the currency of the United States. He'd instructed the Department of the Treasury to print United States notes. Instead, I remember as a young Marine Corps officer holding one of these in my hand, it had a red embossed imprint that said United States note instead of green Federal Reserve. Mafia was upset because Bobby was cracking down on organized crime for the first time in its history with all kinds of indictments and convictions never before in history. The Texas oilmen were upset because Jack was threatening to cut the oil depletion allowance, an incredible tax write-off they got on the ground that pumping oil on the ground was putting themselves out of business because it was a finite resource. Israel was upset because Jack was at loggerheads with David Ben-Gurion, who wanted Israel to develop nuclear weapons, which JFK opposed. All those represent the sponsors, the individuals or groups who wanted Jack out. Then there were the mechanics on the ground. I've identified six of the shooters by name, rank, and serial number, their location, the shots they took, and their supervisors and coordinators, who included Edward Lansdale, an Air Force general, responsible for a string of assassination all over the world, especially in Vietnam under what was known as Operation Phoenix. And believe it or not, George Herbert Walker Bush appears to have been inside the Dow Techs supervising an anti-Castro Cuban shooter by the name of Nestor Tony Escadro, who was firing a Mannlicher Caucano with 3 shots, the only unsilenced weapon used to create the acoustical impression that only 3 shots had been fired, when in fact there were 8, 9, or 10. JFK himself was hit 4 different times at least, once in the back from behind, a shot fired by the top of the county records building by a Dallas deputy sheriff, a shot in the throat that was fired from inside the triple underpass by an Air Force expert, 2 shots to the head, one of the shots fired by Tony Escudero from the Dow Taxi, fired 3 with 2 misses, one of which hit a curbing and injured a distant bystander by the name of James Tague, another missed and hit the chrome strip over the windshield, but the third of which hit Jack in the back of the head, and he slumped forward. This was going on after the driver, William Greer, by the way, pulled the limousine to the left and to a halt to make sure JFK would be killed. And then after Jack eased him back up, the last shot was fired by, from the intersection of the grassy knoll and the triple underpass, by Frank Sturgis, who was a soldier of fortune, hit Jack in the right temple, a frangible exploding bullet that blew his brains out the back of his already weakened cranium with such force that when they impacted with motorcycle patrolman Bobby Hargis riding there, he initially thought he himself had been shot. There's much more about it, but they had to eliminate this obvious indication of Secret Service complicity in the assassination, which led to the massive editing of the Zapruder film. Long story there. I have, by the way, a brand new book on JFK that's available for free order at Moonrock Books. It's over 650 pages, over 1,000 photographs you can find at moonrockbooks.com, brand new book. Then, of course, you had the blaming it on Lee Oswald, who actually, believe it or not, and there's proof in the book, was standing in the doorway of the book depository watching the motorcade as it passed by. He didn't know it, but he was surrounded by CIA agents and operatives. The whole thing was a complete deception. It doesn't appear to have actually even been a book depository, but rather some kind of gun-running operation. They even had created an extra book depository at another location in case the motorcade hadn't come right up Main Street and taken that turn onto Houston and then back onto Elm. Then, of course, taking out Senator Paul Wellstone, that was supposed to be an accident. I was only 60 miles away in my office on the Duluth campus, the University of Minnesota, when that happened. I published 10 articles about it right off the bat, and eventually a book entitled American Assassination, The Strange Death of Senator Paul Wellstone, with a Native American co-author by the name of Don Four Arrows Jacobs, in which we explained what happened. They actually were able to manipulate the GPS and got the plane into a kill zone where they'd set up electromagnetic field that caused all the computerized components on the plane to pop, taking out the navigation and warning devices and communication, but also switching the solenoids that controlled the pitch of the props onto neutral. In fact, that was one of the curiosities when they examined the wreckage, was the plane was on below idle. That's how they brought it down, but they'd also prepped the fuselage to burn intensely to destroy the evidence. Magnesium or some other substance, it burned for 7 hours. They weren't able to put it out, even though the wings in which the fuel was stored broke off when the plane came down in a group of soft trees, and the tail broke off. The fuselage burned for 7 hours and reduced the contents to charcoal. There's a very good article I did about it with John Costella, who is a PhD in physics with expertise in electromagnetism, who assisted us in research on the devices that were used to take out the plane. He's also the world's leading expert on the Zapruder film. By the way, in the book, I published all 486 frames of the Zapruder film in color. In addition, we have, of course, the Sandy Hook, the Boston bombing. The school was closed by 2008. I've already told you enough about that. The Boston bombing may be the most blatant of them all, because you had police on bullhorns calling out, "This is a drill, this is a drill." We have video where you can actually hear them saying that. The Boston Globe was tweeting that a demonstration bomb would be set off during the marathon for the benefit of bomb squad activities. A second tweet saying one would be set off in 1 minute in front of the library. 1 minute later, in front of the Boston Public Library, one of these explosions take place. I'm a former artillery officer in the Marine Corps. I can assure you these were very feeble explosive devices. I don't think they could have killed anyone unless maybe you were sitting on the backpack. If you look through the smoke, there are about a dozen individuals lying on the ground who are missing arms or legs, but there is no blood. As Lorraine Day, MD, from San Francisco, in charge of trauma surgery at San Francisco General Hospital for 25 years, has observed, it's impossible for individuals to have their limbs blown off by an explosion and for there to be no blood. The blood only started showing up later, and it was fake blood, Hollywood blood. They were using amputee actors. I was blown away when a Hollywood director told me he thought they'd use a smoke machine. We searched through all the photos and film, and we found it, a studio-grade smoke machine. I was so stunned by that, I put a photograph of it on the back cover, and nobody died in Boston either. Brothers were photoshopped into the scene, but they made several mistakes. The backpacks that exploded were both black nylon backpacks. The alternative media cracked the case the day of the event by discovering these Kraft International personnel dressed in khaki trousers and black jackets, black baseball caps with the skull insignia where the motto of Kraft is "Violence does solve problems." We see two of them, one with a black nylon backpack with a white square, proceeding to the location where a black nylon backpack with a white square explodes, and then them rushing away, no longer carrying the black nylon backpack with a white square. When they photoshopped the brothers into the scene, however, they neglected to give them black nylon backpacks. So that, in fact, when I consulted a retired professor of law about which of the evidence we'd uncovered was the most powerful, he said that the backpacks don't match, because that meant they didn't even have probable cause for an arrest, much less an indictment or a conviction at trial. Indeed, both the FBI report on its investigation of the crime and the indictment for Zucker in court stated that the two bombs that exploded were in black nylon backpacks, which already exonerates the two brothers. Not only that, but their aunt, Marat Saranova, whom I believe has been taken out over this, who had herself a law degree, a very intelligent, formidable woman, explained to me that she knew they were photoshopped in, and I asked how she could prove it, and she said because Tamerlan was shown clean shaven when he had a beard, and I asked if she could prove it. She started sending me proof, a photograph of him lying in bed with his cat. He had a beard, a link to a workout video at a gymnasium where he and Zucker were working out shortly before he had a beard. She told me a friend of theirs called him shortly after the marathon, relieved to find they'd been nowhere in the vicinity. They had dinner that night. He had a beard. There's a surveillance video from a convenience store where Zucker's inside and Tamerlan out. He has a beard. He's arrested.
But that's moot. If the whole thing was set up as a drill, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I have to. The whole thing was set up as a drill. It was announced as a drill. And then, you know, we've got to go through all this to, like, you know, vet all of this is coming out now. But the point was, at the very beginning of it, it was announced as a drill, and yet we've been strung through the whole thing of it. Wait, there's more. Keep
Oklahoma
going.
Oklahoma City bombing.
I'm curious about that one.
Now, at Oklahoma City, we have two seismic signatures, one from the fertilizer bomb that was parked in the street, distant from the building, couldn't possibly have done the damage. And then there's a second, much more massive seismic signature. There were all kinds of explosives inside the building. The police were bringing them out, unexploded devices that had been attached to the support for the building. And you know, just as they did at Sandy Hook by destroying the school building, they demolished the Mura building too in Oklahoma City. But there are lots of studies that show that was a completely contrived event, apparently in that case, intended to smear militias. I mean, these various events have rather specific objectives. And, of course, terrifying parents out of Sandy Hook, where Bill has described someone he knows who still can't even get his mind open to the idea that nobody died at Sandy Hook.
And all the local news that said there was a second bomb that they took out of Oklahoma City and a third bomb. You know, the best news you can get is from local news. Oh, to get to another false one. Just recently, they went after the Pulse nightclub shooter's wife. Are they just continuing an outrageous story, or do they have something on her that it blows my mind?
Well, it's almost every time I go out and make key points. I mean, in regard to Orlando. The license for the club had expired in 2013. The legal occupancy was only 150. If they'd actually killed 50 and wounded 53, there'd be abandoned vehicles all over the place. They aren't there. I have a correspondent who lives in the area wrote me to tell me it wasn't even a gay club. We had all kinds of phony actors. I mean, absolutely the worst ever, carrying alleged bodies. I mean, there was no string of ambulances to rush them to a medical facility that was near at hand. And would you believe the Orlando Emergency Medical Clinic has recently announced they're not billing anyone for services they did not render. I mean, when's the last time you heard of a hospital not billing for a Band-Aid? And would you believe they put up two musical videos, Dance Orlando Dance, including a bunch of persons made up as physicians, and another with a bunch of police? I mean, it's absurd. It's beyond belief. In fact, I have a detective of 25 years who is also into music, who realized that some of these songs put out by Christina Aguilera and another very well-known musician were out too fast. They were very highly produced. The words were all exactly corresponding with what fit in Orlando. And then they had this huge production with like 100 Broadway stars that were brought together almost spontaneously to do a big thing. I mean, this just doesn't happen in real life. That means there was advanced knowledge. All this was planned to milk it for all it was worth and to make money for the participants.
Huge Hollywood production.
Yeah, and that's like the Charlie Hebdo shooting. All of these dignitaries in the world were standing in front of all of the mourners, which was Photoshop, because they, you know, to get all these leaders together, what was it, two days later? What are the odds? That's not physically possible.
I know. I actually produced a book about this. Again, on my Sandy Hook book, I got 15 contributors, including a half a dozen current or retired PhD professors in Orlando. Similar, the book is entitled From Orlando to Dallas and Beyond. The number of these phony attacks just skyrocketed in the Obama administration, especially since 2012. I mean, it's just outrageous.
Foreign gun control, yes.
In Boston, they also wanted to subvert the Fourth Amendment against unreasonable search and seizure because residents were being forced out of their home without any warrant for no good reason. They brought in a massive military presence to subvert the posse comitatus, which is a statute from 1878 that precludes the use of military force to perform police functions. Obama, on the 16th of January, 2013, just a month and 2 days later, signed no less than 23 executive orders to constrain our access to weapons under the Second Amendment and introduce new mental health criteria at the elementary school level where no one in the world had ever imagined it was appropriate. The idea eventually being that your physician is going to check out whether you own guns and you're going to be eligible for certification as mentally unstable if you don't believe what the government wants you to believe. It's become completely outrageous. I mean, they're trying to set up a situation where they can impose martial law and take the weapons, but you got over 100 million armed Americans. And in fact, in the wake of all these efforts, the weapons have just been flying off the shelves. I mean, it's been better for the gun business than anything else in history.